home for many centuries to a dreadful dynasty of vicious vampire ducks, the Counts of Duckula. Legend has it that these foul beings can be destroyed by a stake through the heart or exposure to sunlight. This does not suffice, however, for they may be brought back to life by means of a secret rite that can be performed once a century when the moon is in the eighth house of Aquarius.
Blood.
Are you getting it?
The latest reincarnation did not run according to plan.
In the heart of Transylvania, in the Vampire Hall of Fame, yeah, there's not a vampire's any other.
Look,
he won't bite, he's the man, cause he's a better again, and things never run plan for.
Look,
if you're looking for some fun, you can now we count upon the wild and wacky one they call.
Dracula.
Hey, Count Dracula.
Hello and welcome to the first episode of Theme On, a proud member of the Radio Anywhere network. I'm PDT, you might know me from Twitter or Twitch as What's On The Tapes. My friends call me Pete, my enemies call me whatever they like, and my parents call me down for dinner. That's right, I'm 37 and I live with my mum. But basically, I'm a really big fan of TV theme tunes. I look at TV theme tunes like normal people look at normal music. So in this show, Theme On, I'm hoping to share some of that joy with you. I'm looking to spread my love all over the audience. Could have thought of a better way of phrasing that. Never mind. There will be no re-record. There'll be lots of re-records. Charlie says hello. But the point is, over the next hour and a half or so, Charlie and I are going to be bringing you some of the best theme tunes. Things you've heard, things you haven't heard. I open the show with the iconic theme from Count Dracula by the multi-talented Mike Harding and Doreen Edwards, who I imagine is also multi-talented. I've just never asked. Count Dracula was, of course, the biting 80s satire about the disturbing parallels between vegetarianism and vampirism. I'm joking, of course. Please don't take offence. I have many, many friends who are vampires. Which is fitting for this first episode, because if all goes to plan, and it rarely does, this is going to be going out on Halloween, October the 31st. So it's going to be an even weirder episode than normal. You know, I'm going to be taking you into a bizarre and disturbing world. You're not going to believe some of the stuff I've got lined up. There's one track in particular that I hadn't heard until I was doing the research for this episode. And, oh boy. But maybe Rod Serling says it better than I ever could.
You unlock this door with the key of imagination. Beyond it is another dimension. A dimension of sound. A dimension of sight. A dimension of mind. You're moving into a land of both shadow and substance, of things and ideas. You've just crossed over into the Twilight Zone.
That's right, we are in the Twilight Zone, people. The Twilight Zone, of course, the American anthology series featuring all kinds of disturbing tales. Very much our equivalent of that, I think. I guess the closest thing has got to be Tales of the Unexpected, which is another show with an iconic theme tune. I don't think it ever quite had the budget of Twilight Zone. The Tales of the Unexpected tend to be a lot more grounded on the whole, which, you know, is convenient because it means that you can swap William Shatner, an airplane and a gremlin for Susan George, Brian Blessed and a nice leg of lamb. Just keeps the cost down. You know, ditch the abandoned apocalyptic library, bring in a lovely cottage in the home counties. But here's the first example of where Themon tries to bring you something a bit weirder than just... Because I put out a call on Twitter. I asked for people's requests for the Halloween show. And a number of people requested the Tales of the Unexpected theme tune. And, you know, I get that. It's a banger, as they say. But I don't think they requested what I'm about to play. Because a few years ago, a rare demo surfaced on Twitter. I don't think it was ever commercially released, but this was recorded by crooner Craig Douglas in 1983. Nobody quite knows what the story was. I think it was intended to go on a Tales of the Unexpected soundtrack that just never came out. But somebody did the thing that I love. They put lyrics onto a theme which was never supposed to have lyrics. That's going to be something that comes up a lot on this show. As much as I can make it happen, anyway. You know, if you request, and I will be taking requests, if you email whatsonthetapes@gmail.com, all of your requests are going to go into my big bucket. I've not yet sorted out the conceit for that. I think it's going to be a big computer. I might get the sound effects from Bertha, because she is a lovely machine. And I'll be picking tunes at random. But let me tell you right now, if you request EastEnders, you are definitely getting Anita Dobson's Anyone Can Fall in Love. That's going to happen. So, without further ado, here's the cover that just shouldn't have happened. Craig Douglas with Love is a Carousel, based on the Tales of the Unexpected theme by Ron Grainer.
Love is a carousel, and when the music plays, you soon forget your lonely yesterdays. Suddenly someone smiles, and then you know so well that you are on love's carousel. Love is a carousel. Maybe you'll find, my friend, that every broken heart takes time to mend. But somehow love goes on. Maybe it's magic spell when you are on love's carousel. Your heart farewell.
The Tales of the Unexpected theme is kind of famous for the fact that it had silhouettes of dancing ladies and it was all a bit sexy. I don't know whether Craig Douglas's version makes it more or less sexy. Please do let me know on Twitter at What's on the Tapes. Did you find that erotic or not? Ron Grainer, of course, wrote the Doctor Who theme, and everyone who knows me is expecting that to come up. I'm a big Doctor Who fan. I can't not. But I figure it's Halloween, so I've got a really good excuse. Not that I need one. It's literally my show. But as I say, Ron Grainer did compose the Doctor Who theme tune. And being 37, I grew up in a kind of weird period. It's called the 90s. But it was a weird period where there was no Doctor Who for pretty much the entire decade. You know, we got one film, that was it. And instead, what we got was a number of different sort of moves by the BBC to try and replicate what they had with Doctor Who, but not using Doctor Who. So you had things like Bugs, starring Craig McLaughlin and Jesse Birdsall and Jay Griffiths. And that's another show which has an absolutely wonderful theme tune. Or there was The Crime Traveller with imagine being Michael French, who played David Wicks in EastEnders. He left EastEnders at the peak of his fame, went on to do The Crime Traveller, which I believe lasted for 8 episodes and then was never seen or heard from again. Never mind, we all make bad career choices. But perhaps the most popular of the Saturday night Doctor Who replacements was Randall and Hopkirk Deceased. I'm talking about the Vic and Bob version, which coincidentally also starred Tom Baker as Wyvern, Marty's supernatural mentor. And I won't lie, I was mainly watching it for Tom Baker, but I was also really starting to get into British comedy around that time. I mean, it was written by Charlie Higson, obviously of the Fast Show fame and all sorts of wonderful things since. Starred Vic and Bob as the titular Randall and Hopkirk Deceased. Starred Amelia Fox of the popular, well-loved Fox family. And for me, as someone who saw both the repeats of the original show in the 90s and this 2000 version, it was a big step up for me. It was kind of a different show. It was a lot lighter, a lot flashier, and you guessed it, it had a banger of a theme tune. But once again, I'm bringing you a version that you might not have heard. I don't know if it was released as a single, but it was certainly, you know, released out there. So this is the lyrical version. It's a David Arnold theme. But you had Nina Persson from the Cardigans giving it some wonderful evocative vocals. And here they are.
So
Now, David Arnold, who wrote the music there, was another person who composed a theme tune to Doctor Who. He did a version for the audio plays, probably around the same time that Randall and Hopkirk Deceased came out. I think it was slightly later. But the reason I mention that is as a handy segue into our next track. This is a request from Ms. Catherine Boyle, who some of you may know. And this one was written by Peter Howell of the BBC's Radiophonic Workshop, who, you guessed it, wrote the... I'm far too pleased with myself with some of these connections that... It's all coming out of my brain, guys. But he produced the 1980 arrangement of the Doctor Who theme. You know, the one that goes... Wee! I'll be honest, I will play that one at some point. I'm not going to play the David Arnold one because I think it's a bit rubbish. But anyway, as requested by Catherine Boyle, here we are with The Children of Green Know. Or is that Now? No. I'm sure somebody will write in and tell me. But from 1986, here's The Children of Green Know.
Baby bar.
There we go, and I did a cheeky little back-to-back there. You know, it's been about 20 years since I presented any kind of music radio. I did Naked Pete's Cheesy Feet on Junction 11 at Reading University, and I mean, I'm not going to tell you whether or not there's an interesting story behind that. I'm going to leave it all to your imagination. So, you know, I'm just relearning all the tools of the trade, like playing two tunes back to back. It's a revolutionary idea. But that was the theme tune from Trapdoor, and it was a single version, apparently written by Bob Heaty, who also wrote the Shakin' Stevens hit Merry Christmas Everyone. And the vocals were performed by Zygott, not to be confused with Zygons, which are a Doctor Who monster. I'm sorry, I'll stop doing it. Maybe by the third or fourth show, I'll stop putting the Doctor Who references in. But, you know, it's really hard to give up. But back to the late 90s, and they were kind of a peak time for sort of telefantasy. You know, you had at least two different Star Treks on the air. You had the likes of Buffy and its spin-off, Angel, which saw Buffy's vampire lover, played by David Boreanaz. I mean, he was never someone who should have led a show, frankly. I always considered him to have two facial expressions, one of which was vampire. So I was never quite sold on the show, but I did enjoy the theme tune. But no, Angel ran for 5 seasons, and it was kind of butchered by Channel 4, you know, because Buffy was on at 6:45 on the BBC. And even that was cut to shreds. Angel, which was always intended as a slightly more adult show, Channel 4 decided, nope, that is our 6 p.m. That is our 6 p.m. hit. I think this was in the days before Hollyoaks, but they put it on at 6 p.m. And I think one sort of 45-minute episode without ad breaks, I think it came down to more like half an hour after they'd cut, and that's when they realised that they'd made a mistake. And I remember it going on at something like midnight, which possibly was an even bigger mistake. But I can promise you that the theme tune to Angel, performed by Darling Violetta, is suitable for all ages. And you know what? Here it is.
Thank you.
feel like we're starting to get quite heavy, so I'm going to lighten things up a bit. There are some shows that just cross the boundary of generations, and one that I always found myself watching with my dad, and we would both enjoy it, was Animaniacs, the Steven Spielberg produced hit, which has recently just come back for a couple of series on Hulu. I don't know what that translates to in proper sort of English. I think what it translates to is BitTorrent, but if there is a legal way of watching the new Animaniacs series in the UK, please do let me know. But one of my favourite parts of Animaniacs was, of course, Pinky and the Brain. For those of you who have never seen it, it's a cartoon about two laboratory mice. One maniacally evil, one terminally stupid, basically planning to take over the world. Now, Pinky and the Brain were both voiced by iconic voice actors. Pinky was voiced by Rob Paulsen, who Teenage Mutant Hero Turtles fans, as it was known over here. That's a story for another episode. But Rob Paulsen played Raphael in the original Turtles cartoon, and then came back sort of 20-odd years later to play Donatello in the 2012 Nickelodeon cartoon. I guess they kind of figured that what passed for cool but rude in 1987 was more kind of a doing machines kind of guy in 2012. And again, that's very specifically a joke to people who know the Turtle theme song. Oh God, can anyone say cancelled after one episode? Sorry, Pete, you're too niche. Go and hang up your headphones in shame. But Brain was played by Maurice LaMarche. And Maurice LaMarche is another voice you'll have heard. I mean, he voiced Kip in Futurama. And it was in that guise that I was lucky enough to meet him probably 5 or 6 years ago now. I was doing some stuff for Den of Geek. And I went to a roundtable journalist interview with several of the cast of Futurama, but the one who impressed me most was Maurice LaMarche, because not only was Maurice LaMarche Brain, not only was he Kiff and many other voices in Futurama, but he was Egon Spengler in the real Ghostbusters cartoon. And I actually got to speak briefly to Maurice LaMarche at the end of the panel. And one of my friends wanted some ident recording for his website, so he was there. And he said, you know, can you do one in Egon Spengler's voice? And all of it, he just comes out, ah, yes, you're listening to whatever the thing was. And can you do one in the Brain's voice? Yes! What is that? You will learn, as this series goes on, that I am no good at impressions. And that is no exception. Anyway, what I'm trying to say is I've got a Maurice LaMarche double coming up for you. He doesn't actually appear in the second track, but first you're going to hear the theme from Pinky and the Brain, which is going to get stuck in your head, I can guarantee it, or your money back. And following that is going to be the theme from Ghostbusters. And I know what you're thinking, PDT, as you are insisting on calling yourself. I've already heard the theme from Ghostbusters. It's by Ray Parker Jr. I know it. And this is that song, but I don't believe it's sung by Ray Parker Jr. And, you know, the pitching is different. Everything's just a bit different. And that's what I want to bring you on this show. Things that are a bit different to what you might know. Obviously, real Ghostbusters fans will know that the theme was slightly different, but they might not have heard the full 4-minute version, because it was only ever used on the pitch video, essentially the pilot, which was an extended music video, still featuring character designs and costumes more based on the original Ghostbusters movie. You can find the video on YouTube. I've ripped the music from there, so. But do look it up if you're a fan of the real Ghostbusters. It's a real curio. So without further ado, here's Pinky and the Brain, and then straight into the real Ghostbusters.
Gee, Brain, what do you want to do tonight?
The same thing we do every night, Pinky. Try to take over the world.
The Pinky and the Brain. Yes, Pinky and the Brain. One is a genius, the other's insane. They're laboratory mice, their genes have been sliced. They're pinky and the brain, 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 brain. Before each night is done, their plan will be unfurled by the dawning of the sun. They'll take over the world. They're Pinky and the Brain. Yes, Pinky and the Brain. Their twilight campaign is easy to explain. To prove their mousy worth, they'll overthrow the earth. They're Pinky and the Brain. Brain, 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 brain.
Starve!
That was the full theme from the Real Ghostbusters, and before that was Pinky and the Brain. The Real Ghostbusters, incidentally, is the subject of one of my favourite slash most heartbreaking celebrity stories. It's about Ernie Hudson, who, to be honest, already got kind of screwed over with the Ghostbusters film. You know, his part was originally meant to be much bigger. It was meant for Eddie Murphy. And then suddenly he gets cast. He turns up on the set and his part's being reduced. He doesn't even turn up until half an hour in. So in many ways, this is not a man who had had a good experience with the Ghostbusters franchise. But, you know, he's an actor. So he goes along and he auditions for the role of Winston Zeddemore. And let's face it, should be a shoo-in because that's the role that he played in the film. Doesn't get the part. His role was given to chat show host Arsenio Hall. I mean, isn't that just showbiz for you? Whenever I see Ernie Hudson, I always think of that story and part of my heart just breaks a little bit for him. But it is funny. Now, we are fast running out of time in this first half of the show. I've got a guest coming on in about 5 minutes. His name's Ben Baker. He's written a bunch of books and he's going to talk to me about his top three theme tunes in a segment of the show that I'm already regretting calling the Dream Theme Steam Scene. But there is a theme tune that I couldn't possibly get away without playing on a Halloween show. And that is, of course, this.
They're creepy and they're kooky, mysterious and spooky. They're all together ooky, the Addams Family. The house is a museum, when people come to see them, they really are a scream, the Addams Family.
Neat, sweet,
petite. So get a witch's shawl on, a broomstick you can crawl on. We're gonna pay a call on the Addams Family.
That's right, it's the Addams Family theme tune, and it's the Addams Family theme tune as brought to you on TV in the 60s. You know, I just figured there's never been a better version of the Addams Family theme. You know, it's never been done better than it. Oh, I can't lie to myself. One episode into this, and I'm already going to have to break my own rules. From the 1991 Addams Family movie, it's MC Hammer with the Addams Family Groove. I just could not play it.
They do what they wanna do, say what they wanna say, live how they wanna live, play how they wanna play, dance how they wanna dance, kick and they stop a friend. Addams Family. They do what they wanna do, say what they wanna say, live how they wanna live, play how they wanna play, dance how they wanna dance, kick and they stop a friend. Addams
just relax. Kicking it around the house. What a knock, and a voice. Yo, can Hammer come out? Now I don't mind being a friend and showing a little bit of flavor. But Wednesday, Bugsley, Gomez, Fester, man, them some strange neighbors.
They do what they wanna do, say what they wanna say, live how they wanna live, play how they wanna play, dance how they wanna dance, kick and they stop a friend. They do what they wanna do, say what they wanna say, live how they wanna live, play how they wanna play, dance how they wanna dance, kick and they stop a friend.
The day I needed to ball a little bit of pepper, my chicken. The next thing you know, coming at me was a hen with the fingers high stepping. Now I tried to play it on off and act like I'm having a ball. But what do I see? Yo, a perm with feet standing about 3 feet tall.
I'm out of here. They do what they wanna do, say what they wanna say, live how they wanna live, play how they wanna play, dance how they wanna dance, kick and they stop a friend. They do what they wanna do, say what they wanna say, live how they wanna live, play how they wanna play, dance how they wanna dance, kick and they stop a friend.
About the Addams, you know the Hammer is with it. Act a fool, no bones, Swoop, Goofy, and Randy, you know we kick it. Now it's the time to get it in your mind. It's okay to be yourself.
Be yourself.
Take foolish pride and put it aside like the Addams. Yo, they dead.
That's a family.
They do what they wanna do, say what they wanna say, live how they wanna live, play how they wanna play, dance how they wanna dance, kick and they stop a friend. They do what they wanna do, say what they wanna say, live how they wanna live, play how they wanna play, dance how they wanna dance, kick and they stop a friend.
Family.
rock and they stop a friend. Thank you, Fester. I need to go back to the bridge just then. Thank you, thank you. Now check this out. They do what they wanna do, say what they wanna say, live how they wanna live, play how they wanna play, dance how they wanna dance, kick and they stop a friend. They do what they wanna do, say what they wanna say, live how they wanna live, play how they wanna play, dance how they wanna dance, kick and they stop a friend. Cause he got on the floor and he got the wiggling and wobbling and he did this cool new horror movie had. Everybody back up.
Now, I'm here in the dream theme steam scene, as for some reason I've decided to call it, and I am joined by my very first guest. It's Mr. Ben Baker.
Hello. Hello. I didn't realise that where I was. I mean, I should have guessed by the surroundings, obviously.
It's very warm. I mean, I don't know what I'm thinking. Mainly it's the rhyming.
I mean, that vent in the wall does look like it's going to explode and kill us all any second, but, you know,
if we're lucky. You know, I feel like steam seam, I feel, is a bit close to Joe Guest's steam room, the late night ITV.
Oh, God bless her. I was doing some work in a book recently, and I had fortune to watch a program called Ant and Dec's Geordie Christmas, which was the last thing they did before SMTV, when they were still with Channel 4. Yeah, I know. And it's the most 1997 thing in the world. It's very good, actually. And it's written by a lot of people who went on to do SMTV.
Is this on YouTube?
Yes, it is. Or it was very, very recently. And Joe Guest is on there as the Christmas cracker telling bad dad jokes.
Oh, dear.
Which is very 1997, but she's great, actually, on that. And it's like it's like Maureen from Driving School's on it. Knickier on there.
Jeremy Spake involved?
Not yet. No, I think his year was just around the corner. And it is actually worth checking out. They're very good.
And indeed, you mentioned writing a book there. Ben is someone who has written books, and we'll get on to that in a bit. But yeah, Obviously, you're mainly a human who likes TV theme tunes.
And I mean, I'm mainly a human. Likes TV theme tunes, definitely that bit. Definitely. I think a lot of where the internet has gone in the last 20 years is lower and lower attention span. And you can still grab someone with a good, even though theme tunes have started thinning out. I mean, we all remember stuff like Lost, which is basically
Lost is not a theme tune. I do not count that.
It's a death rattle.
Lost is someone who walked out past some wind chimes on his way out to the pub on an early lunch break and went, "That'll do."
I mean, there was a lot of "that'll do" about Lost.
Well, that's a whole different show.
Yes, and that is not one of the choices I have brought to your table.
No, the dream theme steam scene is where I ask people about their three favourite TV themes. And I'll be honest, you've shown me up immediately. Because here I am presenting myself as some kind of expert in TV theme tunes, and you've picked three that I have never heard of.
All right.
Well, I've heard of the first program, but I'm not familiar with the theme tune at all. So your first choice, I believe, is from CITV.
Yes, it is. It's the first ever spitting image big spin-off series that they made, and it was a sketch show set in the sewers called Round the Bend.
Well, let's hear it. We'll be right back.
So people who love their 90s comedy, 80s and 90s comedy, to be fair, will definitely pick up on Phil Pope in there. He liked his twangy guitars because he did the Spitting Image theme.
Well, you see, to me, I probably heard it at the time, but I heard it half an hour ago.
Mm.
And it's just a wall of noise.
Well, only series one has the... I'm assuming you've played the whole thing.
Yes, yeah.
Yeah, so only series one had the opening bit, which is a kid basically waiting for his issue of Round the Bend comic to come through the letterbox. And after that, they cut that bit from the titles. And I don't know, it's not the most exciting theme tune in the world, and yet there's something about it that just drives to say something's a bit different coming, something a bit weird's coming up now. And it was. Round the Bend was one of those shows that CITV used to do brilliantly in the late 80s, early 90s. The kind of slightly grubby, slightly anarchic kids' comedy series like Your Mother Won't Like It, Palace Hill, that sort of thing.
I was only allowed on ITV sort of for very specific moments.
Right.
You know, I watched Nightmare and Reboot and a few things, but, you know, mainly we were a BBC family, so.
That's fair enough. I was very much flipped between the two, depending on which one has the most boring boring content slash, you know, basically scouts trying to win awards for being good at stuff, you know. Oh. It's like any comedy for me. I've always been obsessed with comedy. So yeah, I said this is Phil Pope. He did Who Dares Wins, Spitting Image, the awful I nearly picked the Spitting Image theme, but there are several versions. The 1991 in particular sounds like basically pouring several tramps into a bag and throwing them into a threshing machine.
Gosh,
shouting,
I mean,
news!
There's an image.
Yeah.
We do not condone that kind of behaviour.
No, please don't do that. But I say the Round the Bend one, it's all twangy guitar. Like, it's very obvious. But yeah. I don't know, there's just something about it. Just exciting. It made me feel like, oh, what is this? And I think you need that Series 1 version, particularly with the kind of, you know.
So as much about the memories it evokes, I suppose.
Oh, but, yeah. Well, that's it. There's so many things I could have gone for. Like, I think my favourite piece of music, which is a TV theme, is the Taxi theme, Angela, by Bob James. But
you didn't put it in your top three. I mean,
no, because there's not a lot to say about it other than that's a really beautiful piece of music, that. You know, and it to me, because it's actually a song, it's like a 5-minute piece, it feels less like a theme tune. It's more just here's a bit of cool music, you know, that was
sure. Well, I mean, I did notice that none of the three that you provided have lyrics.
I didn't think about that aspect at all. I could have gone for the Lenny Henry show. I always loved it when he said, "That's right, I'm back and it's not a repeat," because frequently it was.
Yeah,
that's a very niche bit of stand-up. I didn't know if Together We'll Be Okay would count. You know, the Cannon and Ball or the
end. Absolutely counts, sure.
Well, it's an end theme. I didn't know if it did, because that is also... But again, that's a song. It's a brilliant song. But it wasn't necessary.
Beginning themes, end themes, we're a broad church here on Theme On. Should we have a listen to number two then?
Yeah. We'll be right back.
there we go, Ben.
Yes, that was a piece of music called Having an Average Weekend by a band called Shadowy Men on a Shadowy Planet. And it's a theme to Kids in the Hall, the Canadian sketch series.
Now, I've heard a lot about this. This has recently gone up on Amazon Prime, hasn't it?
It has, and I'm very, very excited about that because it's one of those things which I saw on Channel 4 in the early 90s. And it's very Python influenced comedy. It's a very scary, it's because it's Canadian, and obviously the Canadian sense of humor tends to be considered more British than American.
It just took them 20 years for it to get over the sea.
It's weird because it's cool, and cool should not work in comedy. Like, comedy themes over here are, you know, it's like zany things are coming tonight, you know, and it's like, and I love that. But the idea that you could do it, it's like I could have gone for the Mr. Show theme. I don't know if you know that, but that's just whistling. And then there's like Fist of Fun did it over here. They had Globos Onward, the kind of a version of that. But like cool themes are very fun and popular. And I don't love it because it's cool.
Well, I love it because Fist of Fun's theme is very short as well. I mean,
but again, there's a 6.5 minute song. They've taken that out.
Really?
Yeah, yeah.
I'm learning so many things as I'm picking out tracks for this.
Some of it won't be worth retaining. But yeah, it's not because it's cool that I love it. It's just, it kind of gets you into this mindset because it's a very strange series. And it's just that kind of like, because it's not like other comedy themes, it sticks out. And also, it's a brilliant piece of music. I mean, I love that kind of twangy sort of Duane Eddy style.
Well, I did wonder, what was it, the band's name was again?
Shadowy Men on a Shadowy Planet.
Is that a deliberate reference to Cliff Richard's backing band?
Because, you know,
it's a very similar kind of style.
Yes, it is. Very possible. I've never actually thought about that. Yeah, well, yeah, they are very shadowy, I suppose. It's very twangy kind of, yeah.
That was the thing that stood out to me, I think.
Yeah. It's a piece of music which instantly makes me feel comedy's happening now. Something cool's happening now.
Sure.
To the point, it is actually my ringtone. It's that, right, or the Vic Reeves Big Night Out theme. I tend to have both of those because they're quite distinctive compared to most things ringtones. I didn't go for that either. Oh, I just suddenly thought of that. To be fair, I did give him a short list of 27 songs.
Well, that's it. I said, can you pick three? You said, do you only need three? You've got 27.
Oh, no.
This is just a bit of the show. This is not the whole show.
It's all about me.
Well, speaking of all about you, should we take this moment? Tell us about your library of work and where people can pick it up. Because you've written a lot of books on television.
Yeah, I've written 5 books. A new one is about to come out, Ben Baker's Christmas Box. And it's basically, I've written a couple of books about Christmas TV, because I feel a British experience when it comes to that. Things like Noel Edmonds and, you know, Only Fools and Horses and The Queen and all that.
Yeah.
Even though they're picked up by other countries, it's very British. It's a very unique thing, I think, to this country.
Well, American sitcoms and things, their Christmas specials usually come out a week or two before.
Yeah.
I don't know. I genuinely don't know what happens on American. Maybe that can be your 6th book.
As far as I can tell, like, American television basically stops making anything new about December 9th.
Yeah.
And they spend the next 3 weeks just bagging out repeats of old stuff. It's very strange. So, yeah, I've written them. I've written books that aren't about television as well. But, yeah, this new one is coming out soon, and I'm very proud of it. It's kind of, I've attempted to get across everything about the Christmas experience. There is actually a chapter on why Noel Edmonds is so associated with Christmas to a lot of British people. I've done every major Christmas Day movie on the major channels from 1960 to 1999, and
wow,
the Box of Delights and kids sort of dramas and the Muppets, and yeah, there's even a whole section on trying to find something new to say about Only Fools and Horses, which is hard. And again, if I'd have picked that as one of my themes, I wouldn't have gone for the original Series 1 only version by Ronnie Hazlehurst.
Why would you do that?
Because it's so terribly... Again, it goes back to that comedy sometimes has to be, hey!
Everything. I was going to say, that's exactly the kind of thing you were talking about.
It's just like, I believe a colleague of mine, Tim Worthington, describes it as Here Come the Zanies would be an alternative title for
exactly
that. Which,
that.
Yeah, it is comedy. But I like that because the obviously just the sheer idea that there was a non-iconic version.
Try taking that to the West End White House.
I'm assuming that's just basically the second half of the show. It's just it's just Grandad looking confused.
I've heard some of the soundtrack on Spotify, and it's basically, if you like Cockney Knees Up, you'll like the Only Fools and Horses music. Give it a swerve.
Not Chaz and Dave work fake. Presumably the artist title.
So if people just go to Amazon or any bookseller,
you got Amazon, find me on Twitter at Ben Baker Books. I put the links up there, and there's always little deals and stuff like that. Yeah, that's probably the best way. Just type in Ben Baker.
Brilliant. Let's move on to your third and final choice. This is apparently your favourite theme tune of all time, in theory. Although you've already told me several which you prefer. To
yeah, I've ruined the format for the first episode. I can only apologise.
Yeah, this is a show called Crazy Like a Fox.
Hello,
Harrison. I need your help.
Dad, you keep forgetting I'm a lawyer.
You're the detective.
Oh, come on, son. All I need is a ride. What could possibly happen?
I've never heard of this show or heard.
Really?
I'm going to have to talk through it.
How old are you? Do you mind me asking?
I'm 37.
Okay, so it was on in the late 80s. It used to run on a Sunday night at about 8:30. And it was one of the sort of last things. If I were good, I was allowed to stay up and watch that on a Sunday night. But again, back then there was the kind of regionalia, so I don't know if it would have gone to every region in the same slot.
I don't think it's the kind of thing that four-year-old me would have been that excited about staying up for, to be honest.
And you know what, back then it wasn't about the quality of the program but the consistency of how late you could go to bed.
Sure.
But Crazy Like a Fox is one of those classic 80s quirky detective shows, like Murder, She Wrote, for example. It's basically there's a dad who's a cop. Well, he was a cop, but he's now a detective, and he needs his son, who's a very straight-laced lawyer, to help him out with cases and stuff, and he gets mixed up. And the surname is indeed Fox. It's a fun comedy series. In fact, there was a series, then there was a couple of TV movies afterwards. And still Crazy Like a Fox is one of Graham Chapman's final TV appearances.
Really? Is he the killer of the week? Or
no, he's a London detective, I believe. Of some description. Wow. Again, it's not about the program here. It is a good TV theme should basically go, hello, this is a program you should be watching now. Watch the program, see the program, feel the program is on. You know, and that is what Crazy Like a Fox. It's that proper 80s horn-based, punchy You know, it's so exciting.
I'll tell you what this theme tune did remind me of. Do you know Little Shop of Horrors particularly?
There are very few dreams I've got left in my age, mate. One of them has always been to play Seymour in a production of Little Shop of Horrors. I've always wanted to. It's my favourite musical.
See, it reminded me very much of one of the songs in that. Mushnick and Son.
Mushnick and Son, sounds great. Three words with the ring of fate. So say you'll incorporate with me. A forest dream comes true. Mushnick and his biting you. What business we'll do for FDD?
This was around 1984, I think. And I believe the Little Shop musical was around that time as well. I don't know what the chances are.
Again, you see, I brought these things to you that you've not heard, and you're bringing new takes on them to me, which actually, you know, genuinely, I never thought about that. But yes, you're absolutely bang on, yeah, mate.
It's just got that kind of similar hook. I mean, it obviously, if they both veer off in different directions, but there's a hook there.
Yeah.
Now, one of the things I like to do with this sort of arena I've been given is I like it when theme tunes that are instrumental on TV, I find versions with lyrics. And
you
actually handily sent me one that's got lyrics.
I'm not sure who the artist is, but apparently he's got very big muscles and is excellent at kissing.
Really? Well, let's just give it a play.
Crimes, oh crimes, such crimes, those crimes, oh crimes, I love those crimes. You've never seen them, but the crimes, you know, it's a crime big show. The crimes are everywhere. Oh, we'll see them everywhere. Crimes behind your chair. Crimes in underwear, no, it's not that kind of show. Such crimes, oh crimes, those crimes, such crimes. I love those bleeding crimes. Because see, there's all the crime all night. Oh crimes, of sight. Oh crime in your eyes, and your face, and your ears. Crimes, oh crimes, we're so the south.
I'm so sorry.
Ben, do you want to explain yourself?
No. Thank you, good night. No. That came out of an episode of a podcast he used to do with friend Phil Catterall called Dullest Chat. And yeah, basically, it's just I love the idea of replacing all the lyrics to a song with as few words as well, putting lyrics to a song, to be fair. I do another podcast.
Did it take you long to write the...
I mean, it's been my magnum opus, basically, for the last 5 to 9 minutes, easily. It's one of those things, like, I do a podcast called Game for a Quiz, and in that, every TV theme tune, that the quiz themes... For some reason, I've decided to record a version with lyrics, even if the lyrics are just blockbusters, 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 blockbusters.
I like how you went for exactly the same thing there.
I don't know why that, but that is one of the ones I did, yeah. it's just, yeah, but as I said, as a theme tune, it's so many things that theme tunes aren't really allowed to be anymore. It's cheesy, it's bombastic, and more importantly, it's like a minute and a half long.
We get that on Netflix now, whenever they want to kind of encourage you to binge it and give you a space for a loo break.
Yeah.
I think that's the current theory of why Netflix seems just so long.
Yeah.
Well, thank you very much, Ben. It's a pleasure having you discuss your theme tunes. There is something we didn't mention about this particular last theme of yours. It was written by, I believe, Mark Snow?
Yes, of the X-Files fame. I love how completely different it is to that. But
it's it's a bit of a whiplash going from one to the
other. Yeah, I suppose I'd say if you're a jobbing TV composer, I mean, like he did Heart to Heart, TJ Hooker, bits of Dynasty, Starsky and Hutch, looking at his IMDb, you know, stuff like that. And then obviously went on to do stuff like Smallville. It's just about sort of preparing to the era, I guess, you know, adapting.
Well, this is exactly the gear change that we're doing now, because obviously this is the Halloween special, so I'd be remiss not to play the X-Files theme. And thank you very much for giving me a perfect...
Is it that weird rave version that came afterwards?
I've decided to go with the original, because I like this extended one that you're about to hear is because whenever you get the videos of the... They didn't put the whole series out on video. They put the important sort of two or three parters.
They did, yeah. I had those early ones, yeah.
And that was the only time that you tended to hear the like the middle eight, as it were, of the X-Files theme. Mm. And so it always meant that you'd just sat through something kind of mind-blowing. You know, I used to rent them out from Blockbuster when the new ones came out, because they were always a year or so ahead. And it was always when the big stuff went down. Yeah, and you'd just be sat there reflecting on it as this sort of eerie middle section of the theme plays. I think it's great. Thank you for joining me, Ben. And if you want to be a guest on a future Dream Theme Steam Scene, I may change the title.
No, I refuse. I refuse to allow this to go out when I see this.
Well, please do email whatsonthetapes@gmail.com, and you've got to put in the header Dream Theme Steam Scene, just so I know. Ben, thank you very much.
Thank you. It's been a pleasure, Pete. Cheers.
That was Mark Snow's theme from The X-Files. Its official title is apparently Materia Primoris, which I believe is Latin for diminishing returns. You know, I do often think about The X-Files when people are talking about the fact that their favourite show got cancelled after three or four series, because I think if The X-Files had been cancelled after three or four series, it would be remembered as an amazing show, like one of the most consistently brilliant shows on television. It went for 11 series. I mean, they did 9, then they came back for a couple more, and I believe in the end Gillian Anderson went, that was really bad and I'm never doing it again. And so far they haven't, but who knows, at the time of recording they haven't. Maybe as you're listening to this they've just announced series 12 and everything I just said is wrong. But in case you've just joined us, you are listening to Theme On, part of the Radio Anywhere network. If you are someone who's currently only listening to this, and, you know, I don't blame you, you've got excellent taste, sir, or madam, or whatever you go by. But if you are someone who's only listening to this, do go and check out the rest of the network at radioanywhere.live, because there are some brilliant shows on there. Obviously, you've got Ian Lee, who I am contractually obliged to mention. But you've also got the Computer Game Show, the Nerdy T-Shirt Club, Fadsome Pod, the Muggy Bonehead Radio Show, and I mean that's it at the moment, but, you know, who knows what's going to happen in future. I think for all of its flaws, though, The X-Files did kind of change television for a while. You know, it inspired, obviously, things like Fringe. But it also had an impact on kids' TV. I know I had a few requests for the theme from Are You Afraid of the Dark, which I've got to say really kind of always passed me by. But the one kids' horror anthology series that didn't pass me by was Goosebumps, based on the long-running books by R.L. Stine. I looked on Wikipedia, there's apparently been 250-odd of them now. That man has got a messed-up imagination. I'm assuming he's written them all, or farmed them out and taken the credit. Written by R.L. Stine with his 10 program associates. But I really enjoyed at the time the Goose. I mean, I was probably a bit too old for them, you know. I was sort of 13 or 14 when I read them. But I really enjoyed them. I know people always talk about the living dummy, Slappy, who of course came back voiced by Jack Black in the Goosebumps movie. I've not seen the second one. I've heard it's not as good. But for my money, the ones I always really enjoyed, well, there were two. There were the Horrorland ones, and I believe they've gone on to be fairly popular. It looked like there were loads of spin-offs. But my favourite, I think, was called Say Cheese and Die. And it was about a kid who got hold of a camera somehow. But whenever he took photos, it would be kind of, the photos would be in the future, and it would always be disastrous. And it turned out the camera was cursed. I was hoping for more of a kind of time travel thing, you may be shocked to know. But yeah, I actually still listen to some of the Goosebumps audiobooks because they're imaginative, they're fun. They are a bit, I don't want to say scary because I'm 37, but you know, they've got some really cool ideas and a kind of horror vibe to them. And they're not too demanding. And let's face it, this is not a time for demanding things. Which is one of the many reasons I don't have children. I mean, really, what's the point of buying toys if you've got to give them to someone else? Anyway, I'm getting wildly off topic here, as I imagine is going to happen from time to time, because mainly I want to play you the theme from Goosebumps. is actually an extended version of the Goosebumps theme on YouTube, but it's really dull. And crucially, it doesn't have the end tag of "Viewer beware, you're in for a scare." Apparently, it was going to be used as basically a backing track for a rap. It's probably just as well they never laid that down. I mean, it's an interesting listen. Do go and do look it up. And it's got some nice key changes and things. But if you're a real sort of theme tune nerd, you're like, ooh, that's something I haven't heard before. But I decided to play the original, because I should say, I know I said earlier that, you know, I always like to play theme tunes with lyrics, and I have got a few coming up, but that doesn't stop me from playing the original as well. So, you know, just in case you were planning on writing letters, or just in case you stopped listening half an hour ago after I said that, just because I've played something with lyrics doesn't mean you won't hear the original at some point. I love all the theme tunes. I am a theme tune slut. Right, stepping away from the horny on main and back into 90s kids TV, there was a weird craze in the 90s for giving films which should never have had cartoon adaptations, cartoons. I know in the 80s, you know, you had the Rambo cartoon. You also had at least one RoboCop cartoon in the 90s. But I want to play you a trilogy because they're only short. A trilogy of theme tunes from cartoons based on horror or sort of sci-fi horror films. So first up, you're going to hear Attack of the Killer Tomatoes. Possibly another part of the Count Duckula anti-fruit and vegetable propaganda machine. Then we're going to have Toxic Crusaders, which was based on Toxic Avenger, which I believe was a trauma film. And, I mean, I've not actually seen Toxic Avenger, but they're always renowned for being rather over the top in terms of, you know, blood, gore and boobs. Really none of which I remember the cartoon ever having. From what I remember, the Toxic Crusader was more a sort of Captain Planet with a sprout for a head. And then finally there's a cartoon whose name I shall only mention once. It is, of course, Beetlejuice the Animated Series. And according to my sources, i.e. YouTube, the theme was written by Danny Elfman. Whatever happened to him?
Except when he has a security leak.
Tomatoes!
That was Attack of the Killer Tomatoes, Toxic Crusaders and Beetlejuice. Oh, balls, I've said it twice now. I'm kind of aware that all of these 90s kids' TV references will probably be lost on quite a large chunk of my audience. I mean, I would like to think that you're enjoying these as music in their own right, but I know there's a lot of nostalgia tied into these things. Which is why I'm about to go further back in time for the theme song to a show that, honestly, I know nothing about apart from the fact that Audrey from Coronation Street is in it. That's right, at the request of several people, too numerous to mention because I am massively disorganised. It's the theme tune from Rent-A-Ghost.
If your mansion house needs haunting, just call Rent-A-Ghost. We've got spooks and ghouls and freaks and fools at Rent-A-Ghost. Hear the phantom of the opera sing a haunting melody. Remember, what you see is not a mystery, but Rent-A-Ghost. At your party, be a smarty and hire Rent-A-Ghost. If you want a fright, climb the spooky heights with Rent-A-Ghost. You can let our spirits move you and for fun play Ghostman's Knock.
Because we in the shop, we hope your knees will lock. That's Rent-A-Ghost.
Let me say the most terrific simple ghost, not scientific, merely supernatural gooies of the day. Heavy footsteps in your attic means a spectre telepathic is descending just to spirit you away.
Yay!
We are extraordinary fellas here at Rent-A-Ghost. To be another you we gather come to
Rent-A-Ghost.
For a biography we ghostwriters, and not forgetting a ghost script. An apparition crypt deep inside a crypt. Ring Rent-A-Ghost. An apparition quipped from deep inside a crypt. Ring Rent-A-Ghost.
Hey, I've just come up with a rather good joke, okay? So bear with me. How does Rent-A-Ghost make most of its money? From the late fees. Get it? Because they're ghosts, so they're all dead. They're already late. As in, like, the late Timothy Claypot. Guys, you've got to meet me halfway here. Well, the important thing is I amuse myself. We are slowly rattling towards the end of this first episode. I still have a couple more tunes to play, but if you have enjoyed it, please, you know, tell friends. And most importantly, please tell me, because I'm sat here on my own in my bedroom at my mum's house. And I'm sat here going, I don't know if this is any good. I hope it is. But yeah, please tell me. Tweet me at What's On The Tapes. Or as I said, if you want to request theme tunes to be put into the big theme tune random jumbotron thing, send me an email at whatsonthetapes@gmail.com. I would genuinely love to hear from you. Unless it's to point out a factual inaccuracy in something I've said, in which case, frankly, you can knob off. Another theme tune that was requested, and again, it's a children's theme tune. I have a feeling that's going to be quite a common thing. I don't want to just play kids' TV theme tunes, but because of the nature of nostalgia and the kind of things that people really want to hear, there's probably going to be a lot of kids' telly in there. But, you know, as I say, send me requests for adult stuff. Not like that. Although I do have quite a few blueies in my wardrobe. Anyway, yes, something people requested was Scooby-Doo. Now, there's been a lot of different Scooby-Doo themes. From TV shows to movies to TV movies, back to TV shows to web series. And I guess the iconic one is probably the, you know, Scooby-Dooby-Doo, where are you? And that's great, that's fine. But I think, I'm going with my choice of Scooby-Doo theme. And this is the one from 2002's What's New Scooby-Doo. It's by the band Simple Plan. It's just a really kind of poppy, vibrant song. It's got so much energy to it, and I think it's great. So here you are. Theme from 2002's What's New Scooby-Doo. There's been at least three different revivals of Scooby-Doo since then, including one, Scooby-Doo Mystery Incorporated, around the early 2010s, which was notable for the fact that it had a kind of love triangle between Shaggy, Velma, and Scooby-Doo, obviously. I mean, they sold the Scooby-Shaggy aspect as platonic jealousy, but I think we all know what was going on there. The family that eats unfeasibly large sandwiches together, you know the rest. Now, one thing I would love to get from this series is some modern theme tune classics. You know, I think it's great that we're all going on nostalgia and the things we've watched in the past, but I'd like to know, what are your favourite theme tunes today? I really want to know, you know, what's the new X-Files? What's the new What's New Scooby-Doo? So again, if you've got any suggestions, please do tweet me at What's On The Tapes. But here's one with a bit of a murderous horror theme that I've had recommended to me. This is the theme from Dexter. I'll be honest, I know very little about Dexter. I know what he looks like because I have seen that picture of him holding a knife hundreds and, you know the one, you've seen it hundreds and thousands of times as well. But apart from that, I am in the dark. As I imagine a lot of his victims are. Yeah, I know he's a serial killer. But I think he kills serial killers to collect their kills or something. I don't know. Anyway, here's the theme from Dexter. From Dexter there, not to be confused with the theme from Dexter's Laboratory, although I suspect that Dexter from Dexter's Lab has just as much blood on his hands as this Dexter, if not considerably more. Now, you heard the Addams Family theme earlier on, and yeah, I like the Addams Family theme, but for my money, I've always preferred the family that they kind of overshadowed, the Munsters. You know, the Addams Family were great, and I love Gomez and Morticia and Pugsley and Wednesday and not so much Uncle Fester, because but there was always something much kinder about the Munsters. You know, the Addams family are sort of embrace their grotesqueness, whereas the Munsters are this family who just want to fit in. You know, they sort of clearly have a troubled background. But, you know, Herman Munster is just this lovable guy who happens to look like a massive Frankenstein's monster. So I wanted to play the Munsters theme, and as I've said multiple times already, I like theme tunes with vocals, and I was already aware that the Munsters has one of those. It's from the 1964 album At Home with the Munsters, and here's a short snippet. It sounds like this.
If you should meet this strange family, just forget what some people have said. The Munsters may shake your hand clammily, but they're not necessarily dead. Behind their house you mustn't be afraid to see a figure digging with a spade.
And that's good, that's fine. But then I started reading the comments, and I was alerted to the existence of something which I think actually blew my mind, and not necessarily in a good way. If you were a fan of the Munsters, you'll remember the son of the family, Eddie, played by Butch Patrick. He was a werewolf or something. But I think it's fair to say that Butch Patrick always struggled with life after being a child star. And although that's nothing to laugh about, and you know, I have nothing but sympathy, what I'm about to play you is definitely something to laugh about, because he put it out there. This is his fault. From 1985, here is Butch Patrick's Anita Dobson moment. Whatever happened to Eddie? I am so sorry that I've just subjected you to that. Well, what can I say? It is Halloween. Thank you so much for listening to this, and thank you so much to my guest, Ben Baker, for taking the time to talk to me earlier. As I say, I hope you've enjoyed it. If you have, please let me know. If you haven't, tell Digital Spy, I suppose. I'm kidding, just please forget you've ever heard it. Actually, no, don't, because then if you forget that you've heard it, you might go, oh, what's this, a TV theme tune thing? That sounds right up my street. And then you'll listen to it again, and you'll hate it again, and you'll forget it again. And the cycle continues ab nauseam. And, you know, I am a bit of a sadist, but only where it counts, ladies. So I threatened it in the first half of the show, and I am going to leave you with a version of the Doctor Who theme. Kind of a spiritual successor to the previous track, even though it was released a good 10 or 11 years before, but hey, that's Doctor Who for you. Although this is more a theme tune cover in the William Shatner sense of a cover, There's not any singing going on there, which may be a relief. But here is John Pertwee, all-round entertainer and the third actor to play the Doctor from Doctor Who. Here is 1972's pop classic. I say pop classic, I can't find any evidence of it ever charting. But here's 1972's Who is the Doctor? I've been PDT, this has been Theme On, and I'll see you next time.
I cross the void beyond the mind, the empty space and circled time. I see where others stumble blind, the secret truth they never find. Eternal wisdom is my guide. Cosmic waste of the darkest lies, to taste the secret source of life. A present science can't deny exists within, outside, behind the latitude of human minds. I am the Doctor. My voyage dissects the course of time. Who knows to say, but are you right? Who searches deep? So dark in the night. For that point, I guide my feet. As fingers move to end mankind, metallic teeth begin to grind. With sword of truth, I turn to fight the satanic powers of the mind. Is your faith before your mind? No, man, am I.